The Blohm Voss BV-155 was a German high-altitude interceptor that flew for the first time near the end of the Second World War. It was a highly advanced machine with the potential to reach incredible heights and was one of the apogees of propeller-driven military aircraft. In early 1942, reports of the capabilities of a new American bomber reached the Third Reich. The B-29 Superfortress could operate at an altitude where no German fighter was effective. To solve this problem, a meeting between officials of the German Air Ministry and the representatives of Messerschmitt and Focke Wulf companies was scheduled for May 20, 1942. During this meeting, two requirements were presented, one for a special high-altitude fighter and the other for a special carrier single-seat fighter. Focke Wulf showed interest in the high-altitude fighter, and this would eventually lead to the creation of the TA-152H, but this is the topic for a different video. On the other hand, Messerschmitt showed more interest in the carrier fighter, since the company had been working in an official capacity on an adaptation of the famous BF-109G to the carrier deck. This new aircraft was initially named the BF-109ST and later renamed the ME-155. Now, Messerschmitt did try to meet both requirements and planned three variants of the ME-155, named A to C, all with different engines. The A variant was to have the DB605 engine and fill the carrier fighter role, while the B was to have the high-altitude DB628 engine and be the high-altitude interceptor. The C was to be a regular fighter powered by the Jumo 213 engine. These were to be developed in Paris, by the SNCAN, in order to relieve the overworked company, as Messerschmitt was developing a large number of aircraft in parallel, like the ME-309, the ME-262 or the ME-163. But progress was very slow, and a myriad of reasons conspired to delay it. One of those was that the French, unsurprisingly, lacked motivation to help the Germans bring the new aircraft to life. But by early 1943, the panorama had changed. The battles of Stalingrad and El Alamein had turned the tide. Germany was now on the losing side, and work on the aircraft carrier Graf Zeppelin was suspended. This was going to be Germany's first aircraft carrier, so it's no surprise that when it was cancelled, so was the ME-155A carrier-borne fighter. During the first half of 1943, the high-altitude fighter project saw little progress, but, eventually, a project divided into three stages and named P-1091 emerged. This new design was presented to the German Air Ministry on June 26, 1943, and came with a request for more manpower, as the Messerschmitt company was still incredibly overburdened. Help came in the form of the Hamburg-based Blohm Voss company, which was known for its flying boats, like the BV-138 or the BV-222, but had no experience in designing fighter aircraft. Despite that, on August 28, the German Air Ministry transferred the P-1091 Stage 3 design work to Blohm Voss and renamed it ME-155B. The two companies started working together, but almost immediately friction erupted, in part because the leadership at Blohm Voss felt that Messerschmitt was holding back information, when in fact the design project was in a much earlier stage than one would assume. We won't go into too much detail about their feud, but suffice it to say that it culminated in a very unpleasant event in November, when a team from Blohm Voss travelled across the country to meet with Messerschmitt and discuss the fighter, only to discover that the meeting had been rescheduled. This prompted Blohm Voss's chief designer, Richard Vogt, to file a complaint with the Air Ministry, requesting intervention, which naturally strained their relationship further. Nonetheless, enough work was done during this period to rename the project M155B-1, but it was still a long way from flying. As Messerschmitt became less and less involved, in around February 1944 the project was renamed BV-155A, finally acquiring its final designation. Now fully in charge, Dr. Richard Vogt came to the conclusion that it would be cheaper to create the B variant with a large series of modifications. The design's main features became set in April, and things moved towards creating the first prototype. A period of doubt regarding the relevance of this project followed, but work carried on, and in August 1944 the BV-155 received its official code name, Karawanken, after a mountain range on the Austria-Slovenia border. But being on the losing side of the war meant that innumerable delays came up, and the first prototype, the V-1, was only completed on December 22, 1944. Further work was necessary, and the BV-155 flew for the first time on February 8, 1945. But due to problems with the right radiator, the first flight was cut short. The second flight, 2 days later, met more success, but still several issues were found. The BV-155 flew for a third time on February 28. But Germany was out of time, and the ambitious plans to make the BV-155 fly at unbelievable altitudes of up to 16 km during March seemingly never materialized. The V-1 prototype flew one final time on April 23 and crashed 5 minutes after departure. On May 3, the British Second Army took Hamburg and with it the Blohm Voss facilities, finding the BV-155 second prototype, which was halfway finished. This prototype was shipped to Great Britain, where it was shown at the German aircraft exhibition at Farnborough. Later it was sent to the US, where it languished for several years in crates. Finally, it was moved to the National Air and Space Museum Paul E. Garber Restoration Facility, where I believe it is still. But addressing the elephant in the room, those wing-mounted radiators, the BV-155 had the planned C variant that got rid of them and condensed everything under the nose, with the chin air intake resembling that of the P-40's later models and making the Caravanken look fearsome. Although only the B variant flew, the C was to be the production version, with 27 C-0 pre-production aircraft planned when the war in Europe came to an end. The BV-155B1 proved to be a highly advanced machine, with features like an ejection seat, an armored pressurized cabin, wing fire extinguishers, servo-operated ailerons, or a highly complex power plant combining the DB603U engine with the TKL-15 turbo supercharger. The U variant of the DB603 was tailored for high altitude and could produce 1810 horsepower at sea level or, incredibly, 1600 at 13 km of altitude. It drove a four-bladed VDM-9 propeller. Its wings were of the laminar airflow type, like the ones on the P-51 Mustang. Dr. Vogt said after the war that he thought this might have been the first German plane with this feature. Its armament was made up of one 30mm MK-108 cannon firing through the engine and two wing-mounted 20mm MG-151-20 cannons. There were also plans to replace the MK-108 cannon with the larger and longer MK-103 of the same caliber. Now, the following are the parameters the BV-155 was expected to reach and are based on the statistics recorded in the Blohm Voss documents. Since the BV-155 never went beyond the prototype, these values should be taken with a grain of salt. The BV-155 was on the heavy side, weighing almost 5,200 kg empty and 5,400 equipped. It had a maximum takeoff weight of 6,037 kilos. It could reach a maximum speed of 430 km per hour at sea level and 690 at the astonishing altitude of 16 km, that it took 29 minutes to reach. It had an amazing service ceiling of 16.95 km. This incredible altitude would put the BV-155 among the highest flying aircraft of the Second World War. This is especially impressive if we remember that this was a single-engine piston-powered aircraft. Looking at the BV-155's overall shape, we can quickly see that the Germans were on the right track. It had elongated wings with a span of 20.33 meters and a wing area of 38.5 square meters. As a term of comparison, the American F-6F Hellcat, known for its exceptionally large wings, had a wing area of 31 square meters, 7.5 less than the BV-155. This is how large these wings were, and they probably needed to be, since wing area is important for high-altitude flying, where air density is considerably lower. In addition, these wings had a very high aspect ratio. If we divide the square of its wingspan by its wing area, we get a ratio of 10.74, a very high number, especially for a fighter. The American U-2 spy plane would be another good example of a very high-reaching aircraft with very high aspect ratio wings. It had a ratio of 10.3, very similar to that of the BV-155. Wings with this planform have good lift-to-drag ratios, but they also have several drawbacks, such as a low roll rate. And fighter aircraft typically have wings with low ratios. Blohm und Voss, now with the correct pronunciation, made some of the most spectacular projects in the Second World War, like the asymmetric BV-141 or the huge BV-222, just to name a few. Toward the end of the war, there were also some unique-looking jet-powered projects, such as the P-212. It seems that Dr. Richard Vogt was very talented, but you don't have to take my word for it, as he was one of those scientists that was sent to the United States under Operation Paperclip. He worked for institutions like the US Air Force or companies like Boeing until he retired in 1966. He passed away in Santa Barbara, California in 1979, aged 84. Overall, the story of the BV-155 is a typical one of the last days of Nazi Germany, with some very exotic weapons being pushed through. But the BV-155 was hardly the most outlandish, and, in that sense, it's quite amazing that it was developed until so late in the war. In 1945, the need for a high-altitude interceptor tailored for altitudes above 12K was highly questionable, seeing that, as it turned out, there was no extreme high-altitude bombing and the B-29 was never used in Europe. There were some Allied reconnaissance planes that were able to fly at those altitudes, but I would say that those weren't a priority target in that desperate situation. But it's always easy to criticize something while sitting comfortably on a chair. And, regardless of its usefulness, one can always admire the determination necessary to fulfill this project in the direst of conditions. On a different note, as you may have realized, the BV-155 is now available in War Thunder, and it's pretty cool if you are into less conventional aircraft. Thank you very much for watching, remember to like and subscribe if you enjoyed this content. I will see you again soon.